it is the clash of the governors. Texas versus California. Can Governor Perry poach businesses from the high tax state? Terry.
He sure is trying. Texas Governor Rick Perry is urging businesses to leave California because of its high taxes and move to Texas. But California Governor Jerry Brown is firing back. Ephraim Graham has the story.
Building a business is tough, but I hear building a business in California is next to impossible.
Texas Governor Rick Perry has his sights set on California's business owners. He's hitting the airwaves to solicit companies to move to the Lone Star State.
I have a message for California businesses. Come check out Texas.
California Governor Jerry Brown dismissed the radio ads in colorful language, sending the message he doesn't believe anyone will actually leave. But California could actually be on the losing end of this battle. Critics say Perry's ads highlight the issues that have dragged down businesses in the Golden State for years.
The taxes are high. The regulations are onerous. There's a lot of things keeping them from being able to innovate and to grow their business.
And it's not just a problem for businesses. It's also getting awfully expensive to be a millionaire there. Phil Mickelson, the championship golfer, recently suggested he might leave California for a state with no personal income tax. He often collects million-dollar purses for his tournaments, and California's new 13.3% state income tax, combined with high federal taxes, is hitting him hard. For example, Sunday, Mickelson won more than $1 million in a Phoenix tournament. Automatically, 40% went to the federal government, 13.3% went to the state of California, and 5% went to the state of Arizona. That means 58.3% of the original purse went to taxes. Governor Perry was quick to offer Mickelson some Texas hospitality. In a Twitter message, he said, quote, "Hey, Phil, Texas is home to liberty and low taxes. We would love to have you as well." Ephraim Graham, CBN News.
You know, PBS recently had a series about the Silicon Valley and the incredible innovation that took place at the Fairchild Semiconductor group and what they did. And then they later went on, and some of the people founded many companies, and one of them was Intel, which is just a star. And then you've got Apple Computer. You have all these incredible fountains of innovation. But this high tax regime and the amount of regulations is certainly going to drive that innovation away. They're going to find someplace else. But right now, Silicon Valley is still Silicon Valley. But nevertheless, it's just one of those things that you say, why would California kill that goose laying the golden egg? It doesn't make any sense. Well, we're happy to report the Boy Scouts have delayed a very important decision that could affect their future. And Lee Webb has that story from the CBN newsroom. Lee.
Pat, the Boy Scouts of America has postponed its decision on whether to allow gays to become scouts and scout leaders. The executive board says it needed more time to deliberate because the issue is so complex.
We're trying to do whatever we do with the young people that we serve in mind.
Homosexual rights supporters say no scout units anywhere should exclude gays, but conservatives and religious leaders warn of mass defections if the ban on gay members is even partially lifted. 1,400 members of the Boy Scout Council are now expected to vote on the issue at the group's annual meeting in Texas in May. President Obama's nominee for CIA director is coming under fire for supporting Bush-era interrogation tactics and the CIA's controversial drone program. Brennan is currently the president's counterterrorism director, and the use of drones has grown 700% under his watch, and members of the Senate Intelligence Committee want to know about a leaked Justice Department memo. That memo says American citizens tied to Al-Qaeda can be killed if, quote, an informed high-level official believes the target poses an imminent threat, even if there's no clear evidence against the target.
That justifies essentially a claim that the executive branch can be judge, jury, and executioner.
The White House defends the drone program, however. It says the administration will provide congressional committees with classified information about those strikes. What's interesting, Pat, is that liberals as well as conservatives are kind of angry about this.
Well, it's amazing. They jumped all over George Bush, and isn't it horrible what he's doing? But, you know, you take Anwar al-Awlaki. He was like the number one terrorist after Osama bin Laden. He was the radical cleric that was inciting violence against the United States. He was living in Yemen. He was part of a terrorist group. And the fact that he was born in New Mexico, I don't think is all that significant. Although I heard our good friend Judge Napolitano just inveigh against the program of targeting United States citizens with drones. But it's not like this is a tourist out visiting Yemen for a holiday and we decide to kill him. I mean, that's a different thing. He is now a member of an armed group out to destroy the United States. Just like the FBI has leave in a gun battle to shoot a desperado who's out to try to kill innocent civilians. I'm not all that upset about it, but I'm sure the ACLU is taking umbrage, as well as many others who feel when you express it like the president has authorized the killing of American civilians by drones, it sounds horrible. When you say we are prepared to defend ourselves against violent terrorist groups working overseas, it's a totally different thing. Well, we've got a vote coming up soon on the controversial nominee for the Defense Department, and Lee has more about that.
But no vote in the Senate today on former Senator Chuck Hagel's nomination for Defense Secretary. The vote was postponed after Republicans raised questions about who paid Hagel for some of his speeches and consulting work. They want to know if Hagel got any money directly or indirectly from foreign sources. They also want to know why Hagel has refused to answer those questions. And they say they can't vote on his nomination until they have all the information they need. Iran's president says the Islamic Republic is already a nuclear state. That's what Mahmoud Ahmadinejad told an Egyptian newspaper this week. And some security experts say he may not be far from the truth. Retired Israeli General Amos Yadlin claims Iran has all the material it needs to build a nuclear bomb. He says it needs only 4 to 6 months to enrich enough military-grade uranium to build a bomb, and is just waiting for the right time to break out.
In the eye of the Iranians, 4 to 6 months are too long time. And the situation in the world is not such that they think that they can get away with it. They want the time of breakout to be much shorter, and they are waiting for international crisis that the attention will be moved from there.
Yadlin says the Iranians could cross Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu's so-called red line to take action against Iran sometime this year. Netanyahu told lawmakers earlier this week that stopping Iran from arming itself with nuclear weapons will be, quote, the supreme mission of a new unity government. Pat?
This is an existential threat to the existence of the state of Israel. One nuclear bomb dropped over Tel Aviv would destroy the city. One over Jerusalem would destroy it. The little state of Israel is too small to take this risk. They've got some Iron Dome defensive shield weapons, rockets, but that's not enough to stop a nuclear threat. This is a huge threat to Israel. And I'm amazed, frankly, they've waited as long as they have to do something about it. And I have not been one that favored war against Iran, because there are many elements in Iran that want to overthrow their government. So if a foreign power attacks Iran, then the people will, you know, unify around their leaders, however distasteful those leaders happen to be. But nevertheless, if they have a nuclear weapon or are close to getting it, the whole free world's got to move on this. They can't allow it. You know, Chuck Hagel said, well, he agreed to a policy of containment, and he was stopped short saying, well, the president isn't for containment. He's for prohibition against nuclear weapons in Iran's hands. So we're not trying to contain them. But something's got to be done. This is a very serious situation. Lee?
Pat, a State Department study on Israeli and Palestinian textbooks says both sides are biased against each other. But as Chris Mitchell reports, some experts wonder if there's an agenda behind that report.
Israel has long charged that Palestinians teach their children to hate Israel at school and through the media. Now a research project paid for by the State Department claims, at least in textbooks, that's not true.
And the result shows that there's almost no stereotype, there's no hate speech, there's no inciting for violence in the Palestinian textbooks.
American, Israeli, and Palestinian researchers spent 3 years examining hundreds of textbooks to determine how the two sides portrayed themselves and each other. Palestinian Authority Prime Minister Salam Fayyad welcomed the research, saying the conclusions are not in line with standing preconceived positions. But Israel wasn't so happy.
This attempt to compare Israeli textbooks, who deal entirely with the question of how you promote peace, with the Palestinian textbooks that deal with exactly the opposite, how do you promote a culture of confrontation. This comparison is really something is wrong and distorted.
Researchers claim to use a new method that maximized objectivity by focusing only on positive or negative statements, not on truth. For instance, the study says putting the 1972 Olympic massacre in Israeli history books casts Palestinians in a negative light. Why? Because the terrorists who killed the 11 Israeli athletes and coaches were Palestinian.
If facts included in history books in Israel are presented as if Israeli books present Palestinians in a negative way, what else do we need in order to prove that this is a libel?
Researchers admitted the report had its limitations.
We think the textbooks are important, but we certainly know the textbooks aren't the whole story. They do not include the Holy Scripture, nor are there other things. What goes on in the classroom? What goes on in the media?
That's exactly where experts say the study went wrong.
They didn't put about 40 items, significant anti-Israeli items, in the Palestinian books.
Kupervasser says if the study was meant to help the cause of peace, it will do the opposite.
I'm afraid that this report is going to be used in order to whitewash the Palestinians from the need to really tackle the major problem that prevents us from promoting peace here.
Chris Mitchell, CBN News, Jerusalem.
Here at home, say so long to Saturday mail delivery. The financially struggling U.S. Postal Service plans to stop Saturday deliveries to help trim costs. The service is expected to end in August, and it will mean a cost savings of about $2 billion a year. Package delivery will continue 6 days a week, though. Package delivery has increased 14% since 2010, but letters and other mail have declined with the increasing use of email and the internet. I can't imagine, Pat, that too many folks will complain about this. What do you think?
I don't think Saturday delivery makes a whole lot of a difference. People work Monday through Friday. They get Saturday and Sunday off, and so you don't get letters on Saturday. It just gives you a day of rest, so I don't think that's all that bad. But what is the deficit? Is it $14 billion that the Postal Service is running? It's a huge deficit, and it doesn't seem a couple billion, isn't much. They've got a whole lot more to go. And it just may be that they can't make it. People are using email all the time now, and if you don't have to buy a stamp, put the stamp on an envelope, take the envelope down to the postal box, drop it in the box, and then wait several days when all you have to do is get to a keyboard and hit a few strokes and you've got the message instantly to somebody's hands and it's free. How can the post office compete with that?
The man behind last year's shooting at the Family Research Council's Washington headquarters pleaded guilty today to committing an armed act of terrorism. Floyd Corkins faces up to 30 years in prison for the attack at the conservative Christian lobbying group. Corkins shot one man in the arm during the incident, but in his plea agreement says he intended to kill as many people as possible during the August shooting. According to the plea, Corkins targeted the FRC for their stance on gay rights. This week marks the 70th anniversary of the heroic sacrifice of four chaplains in World War II. The chaplains were serving on board the transport ship Dorchester when it began to go down off the coast of Greenland. The chaplains, one Methodist, one Jewish, one Catholic, and one Dutch Reformed, handed out life jackets and gave spiritual comfort to the soldiers. When the life jackets ran out, they each gave away their own and went down with the ship. In 1957, Congress established a National Day of Remembrance to honor their sacrifice. You can learn more about this story and get the latest from CBN News by visiting our website at cbnnews.com.